I wanted to say a little bit, having listened to people here in the discussion, that there are two problems in terms of adaptation. One is for the person who adapts, the director or the screenwriter. The other is the perception of the audience. The screenwriter, of course, as you've heard from the discussion, has to take a book and see what you can do to put it on film. But that's his problem. But for the viewer, very often there's a disappointment if someone has read the book, and especially liked the book a lot. What'll happen is that the person will, having read it, will maybe cast it in his imagination, his or her imagination, and that person will also maybe be disappointed that something in the book was left out. I think, you know, you referred to that. So that it's a double kind of situation, and I think with most adaptations, sometimes for the viewer, it's better if they haven't read the book. If they come to the film fresh, then not the comparisons that they also have to make. The other thing is that I'm interested in, you know, I don't want to talk about all of this now, but I just want to talk a little about the kinds of changes that come along in the middle of work. And I recall I had a conversation with Jean-Claude some time ago when I was referring to the film That Obscure Object of Desire that you wrote with Luis Buñuel. Mm-hmm. And this was very unusual because sometimes you'll have an actor and actress playing two parts, but here you had two actresses playing the one part. And of course, it was very effective for the film because, the man who was chasing these two.
Full disclosure, Bill, that was talked about this morning, so we all do know about the fact.
Okay, so I want to tell
you. You can jump right to.
I want to tell you a story about it.
That's great. Okay.
Just briefly, I asked you why Buñuel did this. Whether it was a stroke of genius, and I don't know whether you were telling me the truth or just telling me a story, but Buñuel said he looked at the two actresses and he couldn't make up his mind, so he wanted both of them. Is that what really happened? He didn't have a stroke of genius to do something, but it was just...
No, Buñuel liked very much reading, you know, he was a great reader, and as I said this morning, he was a fan of Dostoevsky. You know, he was reading very, very good novels all the time without ever trying to adapt Dostoevsky, you know, into a film. But he had a special connection with some of the French novels from the end of the 19th century that he enjoyed very much when he was young, when he was a student, with Mans, you know, Octave Mirbeau, that we adapt, you know, and so on. So all these French novelists, quite scandalous at the time, until the 70s and 80s, almost a century later, he was always talking and thinking about them, you know, like Pierre Louis, of course, also the last film, that Obscure Object, is an adaptation of a book by Pierre Louis that he already had done in his 50s, and he couldn't produce the film. He wanted to make it with Stefania Sandrelli, you know, the Italian actress, and Vittorio De Sica, like the main protagonist, which was a very interesting cast, but he couldn't. And the film was badly made by a French director with Brigitte Bardot instead, and in French. So he had a constant relationship with literature, you know, that's, but he was not, the question I'm wondering all the time, Buñuel was not a good writer. I mean, he didn't even like his writing, his letter, su lettre, mm-hmm. How they say in
his Spanish. Handwriting.
He didn't like
his handwriting.
He didn't like to take pictures. At all. He was not a good drawer at all, you know. But he was a fantastic filmmaker. So my question is always all the time, what would Buñuel have done one century before? And how many great directors have lived before the invention of cinema, you know, in history? You know, we will never know. But he adapted himself perfectly well. As soon as he came to Paris, when he was 23, 24, he encountered the cinema. And he was fascinated by the special effects. And he went back to Madrid with some reels, some films, and he gave a lecture, a public lecture, to show to the Spanish audience what cinema could make. You know, and, you know, the plant that grew very fast, the diver who comes back to the to the diving place, you know, all of this. He was totally, extremely interested by that new way of dealing with the reality, I would say, you know. So, and he found his way.
It's interesting when you think of Spain, too, that in the 20s, his two closest friends, associates, were García Lorca and Dalí,
one of
whom was a person of words, and one of whom was, of course, a person of images, and then he kind of combined.
He always said that Lorca, who was 1 year older, had opened to him a door leading to another world, the world of expression, of expressing, you know, that without Lorca, who knows, you know? And he himself noticed Dalí. Dalí was much younger. He was four years younger. But the three of them, I mean, the story of the three of them, until today in Spain, 15 books are published a year, every year, about that encounter, which is the center, not only of the Spanish culture, but Hispanic culture. Mm-hmm. There is not a comparable, not even can be compared to this. Mm-hmm. You know? It's incredible. I mean, and he told me, of course, a lot of stories. And Lorca never tried to make cinema. Mm-hmm. He was a poet, and he was also a dramatist, of course, a playwright. But he never tried to, and they were reading to each other. You know, Buñuel told me that once Lorca invited Dalí and Buñuel to a reading. In a cafe, you know, I'm going to read a play that I have written, and so the three. Imagine the three of them. I mean, the three greatest names in history. And so he starts reading the first act. At the end of the first act, he says, "So what do you think?" And Buñuel, who didn't like it very much, said, "Well, it's good. It's very good. It's interesting. Very well written. Maybe here and there are some details that you know that, and so on." And he said to Dalí, "And so, what do you think?" "Buñuel tienes razón. Es una mierda." "Buñuel is right. It's a piece of shit." That was the kind of, and that multiplied by the fact that Lorca fell in love with Dalí. Try to make love to him. I mean, all the stories are.
There's a funny story, actually. The first time that Andalusian Dog was shown in Madrid, there was a special screening, and Lorca went. He'd, by that point, fallen out with Buñuel. Yeah. At the end, he stormed out and screamed, "El perro andaluz soy yo!" I'm the Andalusian Dog.
Yeah. But it was just for a moment. I mean, they were friends until, even in the 70s, when Buñuel was talking about Lorca, he was still crying.
Yeah.
Yeah, of course.
But Dalí, I think that was a bigger split.
Yeah. But before Lorca, you know, they were in Madrid, before Lorca went down to Andalusia, where he was going to be shot, Buñuel tried to prevent him to go down. Say, "Be careful, it's dangerous." But Lorca wanted to go, and he was shot. And Buñuel always told me, it's even very moving for me to tell it today, that probably Lorca, before he was shot, was very, he was fearing death a lot, you know. So probably he had a few hours of nightmare.
Bill, back to you. Well, you know what the link up is, either Lorca or shit or one of the
If I may say something which could you know, throw a light about our discussion today between literature and cinema. The story is that a couple goes to see a film in a theater. They see the film, and at the end, they see another couple there with a dog, a big dog. And the dog is applauding to the film. So the man said, but is your dog applauding to the picture? And the man says, yes, which is quite surprising, because he didn't like the book. So it's
what can one say after a story like that? And you raised the question, Tom, just at the beginning, of how screenwriting may have changed over the years.
Yeah.
One thing I've observed for the finished product is there's a problem of pacing now, mm-hmm. because you have a whole generation of people who are going like this all day long and don't have the patience to sit through the kind of picture maybe Satyajit Ray might have made years ago. Mm-hmm. So I wonder, when you're writing, whether you are conscious of all of the pacing and changes in audiences these days. Do you have a thought about that? Or?
Well, I think we are coming a long way. Buñuel himself told me that when he wanted to see a film for the first time when he was 7, 8 years old in Zaragoza, next to the screen, there was a man with a bamboo stick, you know, explaining, you know, the film. Because the language was so new that nobody could understand the relation between, you know, counter, shot, you know, what does it mean, you know. They were lost. The language was... And step by step, what I realize now at my age, the audience has been getting used to this new language. For instance, in the 30s, if I say to you, let's meet tomorrow at my office, which is 72 West 9th Street, okay? You say, all right. The next shot will be 9th Street, you know, then the number of the building, the men arriving, not to lose the audience, you know, to make them know where they are. And then I enter, I'm looking for the number of your office, I knock the door, and today all of this is out. We go directly to the scene, and even we go directly to the middle of the scene, to the most exciting moment of the scene. Not, you know, with all the whereabouts, where are we? Well, but that's out.
Even before the credits.
Yeah, even before the credits. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Because in fact, it doesn't matter whether it's 9th Street or 23rd or Saragossa.
Doesn't matter. Absolutely, you're right. When I start working but I'm the only one to speak, but say something. I mean,
I'm telling mon stories. Cher, if you remember.
No,
you are the centerpiece here.
I started working in the movie field at the very beginning of the 60s, 61, 62, with Pierre Etex and Jacques Tati. At that time, the scripts were not written the way they are written today. It was totally, there were technical objects. Mm-hmm. You know? Everything was there, the diaphragm, mm-hmm. you know, the how the shot was, sometimes even a lot of drawings, mm-hmm. storyboards, you mm-hmm. know, because mm-hmm. all the films were, almost all the films were to be shot in studio. So the script was not only a narrative mm-hmm. object, but a descriptive object. Mm-hmm. You give this to the technicians, they know exactly where to put the camera, you know. Which
so the screenwriter would write camera?
Absolutely,
really?
Absolutely, huh. Absolutely. I did it sometimes, you know. At the very, very beginning. And then when came the time of the new wave, shooting out of the studio in a natural light with mm-hmm. a different mm-hmm. film, you know, much more sensitive, mm-hmm. all of this step by step disappear. You know? And we go directly to the matter of the scene, not to the way the scene was to be shot. Mm-hmm. Again, Buñuel. Buñuel went to Los Angeles, was invited in the early 30s. Mm-hmm. And he was, I don't know how, he was a very good friend of Joseph Sternberg. Mm-hmm. Two great filmmakers together, you know. And one day he went to see one of the shootings of Sternberg in a studio, in a big studio. I think it was Shanghai Gesture or something mm-hmm. like this. So he entered, and there was a lot of Chinese people in the studio, a harbor, a boat, a car, you know, some people, the cameraman working and working around, but Joseph wasn't there. Yeah. So he asked, where is the director? Oh, he must be at the bar, you know, at the cafeteria, having a drink. They were preparing the shooting according to the script, you know. And the only work of the director was to direct the actors.
The actors.
That's the only thing. Everything, the film was made by the stage, by the designer, mm-hmm. by the editor, by the cameraman. You know, they were. It's a totally different way. Today, it would be unthinkable mm-hmm. that the director wouldn't be there, you know? Mm-hmm.
Phil, in your career, did you get scripts that had camera movements or now we turn to a close-up or anything like that?
If I write
if you
a
wrote,
script,
yes, of course.
I put that in.
Yeah.
If I can see it in advance, yeah. So because, and there is a purpose for storyboards nowadays. Mm-hmm. In fact, more now really? Than in the past, films are storyboarded so that you can sit with all your people and say, you know, we're going to need this. Even if they're not precise, everybody knows what needs to be done. If there's going to be an elaborate camera move, it's good to have all of that done. Costumes, there are storyboards are not, especially, you know, more and more special effects movies are done so that we have blue screen, green screen, and you need to sort of plan all of that out. You know, the other side of all of this, and I agree that, you know, films, you cut more closely, you move things along, but there's that other side of things of, I remember when George Lucas said to me many years ago, we were friends, he said, I'm going to make movies for 12-year-olds. And I said, oh, come on, George, no. Well, he was right, he did, and the audience, except for this vast crowd here, is largely a 12-year-old mentality. It's not only this, it's not only other things, and, you know, with the progress of, you know, I mentioned something yesterday when, you know, I loved Buñuel's camera movements. They were so elegant. And shooting a few films in Europe, I realized the economy of a lot of the French and European filmmakers where they would put a dance floor down and move the camera in and out. You could do a handheld shot, but it was jittery in those days. You didn't have a built-in gyroscope. You know, now all of that has changed. You can just come in with the camera. And there was an economy in European films of they didn't have enough as the money that Hollywood films had. So if you went around to light and match on the other side of the, you know, it could take hours to do that. So Buñuel was so elegant, the way he would move in, somebody would come across, you know, the scenes were, you know, very well mixed you know, now, you know, studios, some of this is from studios. They want, Hollywood's always had this, they want the master shot and then where's your close-up? Mm-hmm. Where so that we can cut the movie and we can move it along because we are, you know, nervous and we want the audience to, you know, we don't want to leave any air in the film. Well, you know, I like air and I think audiences appreciate that. People who go to museums, I've been looking at the still photography and you stand there and, you know, you are the one who judges that. The digital thing, we used to have, up until fairly recently, you could say if the studio wanted to recut a scene, you'd say, well, that's going to cost so much money because, you know, we're going to have to remix it for you. It might be $20,000. Oh, okay, we don't need to do that, they would say. But now with the digital, it goes right to their offices and they're participating in a lot of the things that, you know, that should be left with the filmmakers. And by filmmakers, I mean not only the screenwriter, the director, cinematographer, all the people who are on the battlefront. Mm-hmm. You know, studio, I don't mean to go on a tirade against the studio mentality, but it's become easier and easier for them to intrude, and there are more and more people in the studio thing, and even with independent films, the company will have all, you know, it used to be you worked, you know, if we worked for Saul Zance, it was Saul Zance that mm-hmm. was, and he left us alone. But now a company will have 10 people who just, they were in Princeton last year, and now they're executives, and, you know, and there's a lack of sophistication, elegance, slowness of appreciation, and it's. But maybe it's going the other way as well. Maybe a young, you know, different filmmaker can influence. Mm-hmm. The thing that young and it's not necessarily young, but that nervousness can do to dictate films, nervousness can become boring to people too, mm-hmm. and a new kind of cinema can, there's new things can start happening again. So mm-hmm. it's hard to say.
But we all know that. Excuse me.
Yeah, I think. Of course. For example, in France, you know, there is the TV standard. They gave the life for a scriptwriter, for filmmakers. So they have very standard things to give to filmmakers mm-hmm. to say you have 10 minutes. In this, you have to shoot in this, this sequence. During of this weekend, it would be 1 minute, 2 minutes, 3 minutes. Yeah, now it's all is standarding. You know, it's very special. So now it is the law of TV. Mm-hmm.
Has moved to cinema.
Cinema. Right. Yeah. Now. For example, there is a law in TV. They said if you don't change the shot, you are shot. You know, a shot, the audience change the channel. Uh-huh. So, we have to when we write for the TV now. So we have to think about okay, every time we have to change after 1 minute maximum, we have to change. Not only the shot, but the sequence. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This is true. Speed, and now it's very speed, very fast. So mm-hmm. this is really another kind of to make a movie. And now, unfortunately, everywhere, I think this is the TV takes the place of everything. They give sa loi.
It's a rule.
Rules, yeah. And it comes even before TV. It comes out of commercial shooting. Mm-hmm. You know, the people, the directors, fast cutting, free association, ultimately to sell a product.
So is this in any way positive or is it all negative?
Well, it could be, I don't know. In some ways, there might be, are there parts of the brain that are digesting things more quickly?
We are changing the language of cinema. This is a new language, I think, for young. One month ago, I had a workshop in North of France with young filmmakers and scriptwriters. So they know that I worked with Jean-Claude Carrière, So please, you work with Jean-Claude Carrière, so he can work with so many big filmmakers, etc. Yeah. So why he refuse to say that there is in script writing, there is not a method, there is not the règle. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
No rule.
No rule. Of course. Yeah. Yeah, this is rules, because if you put that, you have to make and write for TV, but he doesn't work for TV. That's like he worked with very big filmmakers. So each filmmaker has his roles, his universe, his worlds. Mm-hmm. So every time he changes and he had to adapt himself to with this. With the filmmaker's world, mm-hmm. That's all. So, but new generation, he don't know everything. He says there is already role. This is a standard things.
That's the most dangerous.
Yeah.
Think about mm-hmm. to believe that there are models, that there are standards that you just have to imitate. You know.
Yeah.
That you have done on the minute 17, something has to happen, which is absolutely ridiculous. You know, all the films we like do not obey to rules at all. The first rule is the freedom. You know, can you imagine Shakespeare and Dostoevsky following the rules of? No, it's unthinkable. You know. But you're right. Many people believe that to write a good script, you have to follow some rules. Some models. So if you follow any model, you imitate it, and you are just an imitator, a follower, and there will be absolutely no chance to write something new and interesting. Absolutely no chance.
Bill mentioned before something about how now, of course, there is a tendency from a few years back of very, very quick cutting and whatever, but an opposite tendency has been what people call slow cinema. I'm thinking of Bellatar or even Kiarostami or Nuri Vince Chalon or directors like that. What do you think about that in terms of rhythm and how does that work? How does Bellatar work with the screenplay?
No, what you call the slowness of Kiarostami is his way of shooting. That's all. He couldn't shoot otherwise. And if he became Kiarostami, it's partly due to it. You know, of course, you can't oblige Kiarostami to shoot like... you know, this 3 seconds film made in Hollywood, you know. No one shot longer than 3 seconds. So I can stand it, you know, because I know it's a method, you know. I know it's a sort of
trick.
Way of cutting, tricky, you know. So you deprive the filmmaker of everything, you know. You can't call him an artist. You know, it's just a maker, you know what I mean? It's just following. I know it's a dream of many producers to find the key, you know, to open the drawer where is the real method to make, not good films, but financially interesting films, you know what I mean? Good films, they don't care at all.
But slowness is an aesthetic that's been difficult for film to adapt to. It happened earlier in theater. Robert Wilson introduced slowness into theater, and you know, when you saw Deaf Man's Glance, for instance, where for 8 hours they moved logs from one side of the stage to the other, and if you survived that, you entered a different realm. And there are films that have managed to do that, but they do need a new language, and they have found some.
No, but if you have a long shot where nothing happens, it's boring, of course.
But sometimes you have obviously to pass through a wall of boring, and there's something at the other end.
That's the question. That's the liberty of the filmmaker, of the artist.
Yeah.
I remember in a film by Jonathan Glazer called Birth, with Nicole Kidman. We ask Nicole Kidman at one point, she has a problem with a young boy pretends to be the reincarnation of her dead husband. So she goes to in a theater and then we ask her to just to be like this, without any emotion, for 6 or 7 minutes, you know, which is a long time, looking at the screen. But a lot happens during that time because we think, you know, in her place, you know, we are trying to see what is she thinking about, what does it. We know what she is thinking about. We don't need to tell or to. And that's a, it's a beautiful shot. I mean, that she understood perfectly well. You know.
One of the things I do.
Singe Sabour is not a slow film at all. I mean, to me, a lot of things happen in Singe Sabour. But the rhythm is normal. It's like a lifestyle, I would say, you know. It's quite interesting to see in Shakespeare or all the great writers how they play with time. You know, it's every great, not only Proust, but all the great writers have a special relation with time. You know, that they a character usually in a scene from beginning to end, the characters are there. We can see them. You can. Godard was the first in Abu Dussouf to cut inside a scene, you know, the same set, the same moment, the same action, but different moment of the same. He was the very first one, and which was very daring at the time, you know, and people were protesting. Now everybody does, you know. We keep only the interesting moments, you know. In Shakespeare, we have, I said already, that somebody is entering the stage, many things happen. And when he leaves the scene, 5 years have passed by. You know? And that's, you know, playing with time is the dream, to be stronger than time, you know, for once. In life, I can't do anything against it. But when I'm writing, when I'm making a film, when I'm directing a play, I can't be stronger than time, you know?
Billy, what's that?
I was going to say, one of the things I do is show my students, I have them read Death in Venice by Thomas Mann, and then I show them Death in Venice, which is a prime example of a very slow film. But what's interesting is that Visconti tried to, with the slowness, tell a metaphorical story by what I consider sort of sensory film. He changed von Eschenbach from a writer to a composer and conductor. And so that gave him the opportunity to make music a big part of it, to get people in the proper mood. And so they used a Mahler score, I think the third and the fifth symphony from Mahler for that. And the story just moves so slowly to try to get people to identify with the protagonist. But it's a very slow thing, and the students have a lot of problems with it. Some people think it's a very beautiful film and it's challenging. And if I ask how many people feel it's too slow, almost every hand in the class goes up. They're just not used to that. But slowness, it isn't like nothing happens. Something is happening, but little by little and step by step.
Now, death is coming on tiptoe, you know, in this film. You feel it at some indications. I like it very much. I mean, that part of the film, you know. And it's like... we cannot enjoy our death because we are dead already. We are either we're alive or dead. But in the film, they try to make longer, as long as possible, the moment of dying, which I like very much. You know that, with some.
I think it's when we talk about time, it's interesting to just think about the concept of rhythm and how you put in rhythm into the film. Philip, could you talk about that? I mean, actually, Annette brought that up yesterday about the rhythm, you know, that exists in Unbearable Lightness. Is it something that's just editing, or is it something that really?
Well, it's something, you know, obviously, when Jean-Claude and I talked about it and spent a lot of time preparing the script, we thought of rhythms, but there are rhythms that come in the process of actually making the film. The rhythm, if you have a tracking shot and you can't cut into it, you've got a period of time where that is going to influence the rhythm of that that part of the film. you know, did a film longer than that, The Right Stuff, which basically, I always say it's the longest film ever made without a plot. I mean, the plot is they're going to eventually, but it's but it's based on rhythms in a way. It's based on characters, but you know, you need to stand there with your divining rod in a way while you're making it, while you're directing the actors, while you're editing it, to say this is enough. Unbearable Lightness of Being, the first cut was 4 hours and 25 minutes. Mm. And I thought it was worked fine, but then we started looking at it. We had a wonderful editor, Walter Murch, and you know, we started tightening it up and looking for the rhythms of the film. That's you know, and how you arrive at rhythm. Sometimes the music arrives. And if you can end a scene with some, instead of finality, some sort of expectation, what, you know, so that you deposit the audience into the next moment, that's sort of the key thing. You know, the minute it's something is complete, the audience, well, I was going to say, we don't have the theaters anymore to do slow movies. You know, I mean, we're not, you know, this is something we're not talking about, but it's shocking in the last 10 years, but even in the last 3 or 4 years in San Francisco, all of the, quote, art theaters, smaller theaters, are gone. There's only the multiplexes, and occasionally a good film is in the 8th theater in a multiplex, but, you know, we can't really see the European films easily. You can go to the archives, Pacific Film Archives, you can go to film festivals, and the film festivals are, you know, but the people who go to film festivals are the people who, you know, in a way, they're eating at Chez Panisse and they're not eating at McDonald's. You know, they're the ones who are, you know, preserving, you know, well, Jean-Claude, I'm jumping here, but Jean-Claude wrote a wonderful book with Umberto Eco called This Is Not the End of the Book. And now we're talking about This Is Not the End of Cinema. You know.
Hopefully.
Hopefully. Well, you know, you make an argument. You know, we hope that somewhere like Fahrenheit 451 that there are people, all of us here who have all the images of the films embedded in our minds, that we're going to be walking around and we can transmit these to people who are coming along. But are they interested? Strangely, a number of years ago, I was on a panel at the, I don't know, Santa Barbara Film Festival. And there were a bunch of filmmakers there. And what filmmakers influenced you was the question. Well, you know, Spielberg was old to a lot of these filmmakers. He was the beginning of things. I mentioned Buñuel. There was absolute blank. And this is 10 years ago. There was not, I mean, this was a film festival. It was, you know, shocking. I was talking about, you know, someone they didn't know about. Now, how do we do that? We have this problem in politics. We have it in everything. You know, politics begins, you know, there's no history. And we're all interested in historical things. You mentioned Spain. I mean, you're having this talk about Lorca. You know, nobody knows these people, and they should. I mean, it's as if, you know, somewhere there's a Lorca gene buried inside of everybody, and the problem is how do we revive that? And that is the big question. The question is, you know, what, you know, can... And there's a lot of brilliance now with, you know, young people, I say young, but, you know, people who are able to do things I can't do. When you work on special effects. There are absolute geniuses who are, you know, you can be, you send an idea into your special effects house, and overnight it's done in Australia or India or New Zealand, and you come in the morning, and there is your special effect been generated by people around the world, and if you want to tweak it, you can do that, and somebody can do that. That's all wonderful. The tools are all there, but where is the soul? Where is the spirit? And where is, you know, where is what we've lost? That's...
Où sont les neiges d'antan?
Yeah.
I once asked the class if they, I mentioned Laurence Olivier, and one of the students raised a hand and said, isn't he the guy in the Polaroid commercials? was what they knew about.
Yeah, exactly.
This great actor.
Well, Alec Guinness, Star Wars made Alec. I mean, right. Here he had done all those movies, and people only knew him from Star Wars.
Phil, if we begin to say what will remain of us, we are lost. And we stop working immediately, you know, because nothing... keep working anyway.
Yeah.
Once I was with a friend of mine in Paris, trying to count the theater plays created in Paris in the 19th century, more than 8,000. Mm-hmm. How many of them are still played today?
Yeah.
On what? How many do you think?
25.
Three.
No. But three. Very famous all over the world. Three. La Dame aux Camélias, The Lady of the Camélias, mm-hmm. You Were the King, mm-hmm. and Cyrano de Bergerac. Three. Uh-huh. Then you have three or four Victor Hugo players, one or two Musset, and then you have about seven or eight La Biche comedies. You know? Mm-hmm. The total is less than 20, you know, out of 8,000. All the rest is in the abysses of forgiveness.
But if you go to the 18th century, the number is much better. It's because the 19th century produced lousy theater.
Well, let's go to the 18th century.
Okay. And tell me.
And Beaumarchais.
And Beaumarchais.
And who else?
Rostand.
Rostand is 19, yeah.
Time to time, a Diderot or something like that.
Diderot never wrote for theater. We have good writers, and I didn't quote Balzac or Flaubert, you know. Only for stage, you have Marivaux and Beaumarchais in one century, and that's all. Beaumarchais, two plays, and Marivaux, let's say, six or seven. Okay. And it's about it.
But with film, we have an artifact. Hamlet in 1948 and change it around and try to do. I mean, we have Sachet Ray. You know, we have Kurosawa. We have it's hard for all of us who grew up in this world to think of a world without Mastroianni walking around.
I think we'll have those films in a form. I myself am much more upset about the fact that, say, my students at Columbia go to the movies, as in go to a movie theater, much less than they watch lots of movies. They just don't watch them in movie theaters.
No, they watch them on devices.
So that's why, I mean, you know... there's a festival I like to go to every year in Bologna, Italy, and there's always big discussions about, you know, film versus digital and whatever. For me, that's the discussion's over. I don't know why we're still talking about it in a way.
Yeah, it's over.
That seems to me much less important than this fact that theaters are dying, as you were saying, film literate town like San Francisco.
Theater
is very much alive in Europe.
Yes.
Today,
but I'm thinking about film theaters.
Oh, I have something to tell you. Mm-hmm. That maybe you didn't notice. For your students, it's quite interesting. Yeah. Stanislavski and Méliès died the same year.
Stanislavski and who?
And Méliès.
Méliès?
They were strictly contemporaries. It's not by chance. you know what I mean? The moment the cinema appears and takes the reality, and this is my territory, reality, the theater feels free to open new fields and new visions. You know, it's not by chance. It's not a coincidence. It's at the very, probably Stanislavski saw some of the Méliès films. Mm-hmm. Did Méliès see, it's unthinkable that he went to Rosemont, but he was 2 years older than Stanislavski, that was all.
Wow.
They are strictly contemporaries. You know, yeah. The man who invented the direction, you know, and the man who freed the theater are the same generation, exactly.
That's
something quite
that's
interesting.
That's great. Yeah.
Huh? Mm-hmm. Yeah. If you think of it, I realized this, I mean, that can be only a coincidence.
Yeah, can only be what?
A coincidence, not only, you know.
What year is Uwa?
Something that you mm-hmm. should develop and try to deepen and teach to the, you know.
What year is Uwa by Jarry?
1896.
Yeah, before the cinema.
It's before the cinema.
A few years.
96.
Right? 96.
Well, it's the cinema is 1895.
Same.
Yeah.
Yeah, the same year.
Because that would seem to me another kind of interesting.
Yeah, another kind of coincidence. Yeah, absolutely. Is the when the theater in the 19th century, as far as we know, was totally realistic. You know, people are going to the theater to see their own apartment on stage. You know, with better chandelier, but it was like a mirror of reality. Mm-hmm. And from Stanislavski, Gordon Gregg, Antoine, and all the great theater directors from the first 10, 15 years of the 20th century, theater felt free and it opened a lot of new directions.
Mm-hmm.
And I suppose because he was freeing himself from the representation of reality.
Mm-hmm.
Think about it. There is something there that
there's a lot there. That's why to talk about a course that's not a film course, a course I teach on theater is called Realism and How to Get Rid of It.
Yeah, absolutely.
Do you feel the same way in? I know you live in France, but do you think now in Afghanistan or Iran, there's the same sort of moving away from watching movies or? Is it, do you think cinema's still alive there? Because actually, having just been to India, you know, the cinema, it's like unbelievable, you know, when you go to movie theaters and just see 1,000 people in seats.
Yeah, so and Afghanistan's a very special story about cinema because Afghanistan was every time influenced by Indian cinema and Iranian cinema. But, of course, in the cities in Kabul or other cities, we watched all the classic, Sergio Leone, and Jean-Pierre Melville, etc. Of course, the cinema, Afghan cinema, is very influenced by all that. And now, by this new technology, influenced, of course. Now, there is, 2 years ago, it was a film festival in Kabul, and I saw 50 films for young filmmakers, and it was wonderful, of course. It was not the film, it was short movies. It is 15 or 30 minutes, that's all. But every time, they have so many things to say, to tell. So, you know, this is a very poor country, but very rich in the stories.
Mm-hmm.
So this new generation, they have this conscience, so they have so many tales to tell.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, now Iranian cinema, so many Iranian filmmakers come in Afghanistan mm-hmm. just to teach. Makhmal Baf, he was the first one who made so many films in Afghanistan, and his daughters, two wives, two, etc. And after that, other people. And the same in India. They come in Afghanistan only for the nature of Afghanistan, the paysage,
landscape.
Yeah, mm-hmm. they shoot in Afghanistan, but for 2-3 days, and after they go back to India because he cannot stay there.
They even come to Switzerland to shoot the mountains.
Yeah,
sometimes the Bollywood shot in Switzerland.
Yeah, so. Yeah, this is a new generation, and
the new generation goes to cinema.
Cinema, yeah. Of course, there's now 11 theater cinema in Kabul. Yes, okay. Every time it's full. And also there is the young people make the private cinematheque and their house. Yeah. Hmm. And for example, my film, Sangi Sabur, The Patient's Stone, of course, we couldn't show my film officially in Afghanistan because of, you know, the theme of this film, etc. So all the young people show my film in their cinematheque, private cinematheque, and themselves wanted to present this film an Oscar here, but not government. So this is another, clandestinity cinema.
Yeah. Well, that was, you know, Samizdat in Russia, yeah, and all, yeah, you know, and how vital literature was in all those countries. And then once they got freedom, it was gone. I mean, it really was diminished. You know, there's something about oppression makes people savor more the special thing of that.
Of course, it will be change the vision of this new generation. You know, this is a very old calligrapher and painter, Persian painter. He said, I think French, and you can translate it because it's very...
let Tom translate it.
Yeah. est-ce que on voit d'une différente manière quand si on dessine d'une autre manière?
Répète ça.
The drawing, if you draw a miniature, do you see the same way as if you draw, like in Venice, like Michelangelo, you understand what I mean? What changes do you were looking at?
Yeah, how painting change the vision, you know, physical vision, everything. So now I think the same in Afghanistan, the new cinema, this cinema will change the meaning of people and the vision of the new generation, of course. This is, that was also, I come back to Mohsen Makhmalbaf, Iranian. He was, you know, before that, he was Islamic, very Islamist fundamentalist. Mm-hmm. So, but when the day he knows, you can shoot this bottle with 30, 20 degrees. Mm. So you have 170 angles, point of views, and the same bottles. So everybody can have so many visions about one thing, about reality. And after that, he changes his religion. Really?
That's good.
Well, I thought maybe before we turn to Q&A, I'd like to bring this back for a moment to screenwriting, because that is the subject we're dealing with. And I wanted to ask you collectively, but Jean-Claude in particular, but all of you, we've been talking mainly about books that have been translated by via screenwriting to the screen, and
that was the theme.
Yes, of course. And we've been talking essentially about successful ones. I wonder about another. You know, there are books which are translated via to the screen with excessive faithfulness, too faithfully, and I'm thinking particularly of one. And that's, I think, Visconti's Camus, L'Étranger.
Yeah.
Is that it, Visconti? Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah. Well, make a film of the most famous book of the 20th century, at least the one that sold the most copies, even more than Le Petit Prince, it was a hell of an undertaking and a great challenge. Mm-hmm. And Visconti met it in a very strange way, I think. Which is to you could see the film and open the book in front of you and follow it page by page. He is extraordinarily faithful, and by being extraordinarily faithful, he made a bad film. Mm-hmm. It was good. Not a good film. And with Mastroianni playing Meursault, mm-hmm. I mean, who could ask for more? Well, it just doesn't work. Mm-hmm. I mean, that happens.
The film was in competition with Belle de Jour at the Venice Film Festival.
Well, it's no competition.
So we met with Visconti, and I wasn't that daring, you know, but we asked why he was so faithful to
yes?
the book.
Yes, oh, really?
And it was, say, because of respect, you know, because he liked the book very much.
Yeah.
But I suppose they didn't just make the necessary work to go from one language That's to right. another one.
You know having listened to you for the last 2 days,
yeah,
Jean-Claude, and talk about the kind of effort, the kind of imagination, the kind of work that is required to go from this to that,
okay.
It's clear that that was not done. Yeah. He just went from
this
to this.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm.
And it doesn't work.
Yeah, it doesn't.
That's
in
right.
spite
and
of,
another one,
in spite of Marcello.
Another one that didn't work in the same way with an equally great person, your friend Peter Brook, was Moderato Cantabile, which is a great book, and with Jean Moreau and Belmondo, I believe,
didn't
Peter Brook made a lousy film.
Yeah.
And it happens, right?
It happened.
By being too
maybe
faithful.
Maybe it happened to me, too.
Really?
But,
tell us.
I forgot.
That's the right way to deal with it. The right way to deal with it.
Also, what happens, I'm telling this not because of Atik or Phil, but sometimes when I'm going to the editing room. I said that United, the real place to go is the editing room, because you in the editing room, either you find your script there or it is lost. You know, so it's a very good place to change things and adapt, to help the director to choice, you know. And sometimes feel, not for you, you feel that a director wants to keep a shot which is useless because he fell in love with that shot. You know? Because it was very difficult to shoot. He remembered how difficult it was, you know. How he loved, and the
promises he made the actress.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right.
So you have sometimes with a soprator, real diplomacy, to convince the director that he has to cut this, you know.
No, right.
And sometimes it's not so easy.
Yeah. No,
it happened to me. Never with Buñuel, because Buñuel was shooting already edited, you know.
Yeah,
he
yeah.
knew it perfectly yeah. well, and editing was taking 2 or 3 days, no more.
No, yeah.
Just to cut. But sometimes you wonder why the director does insist in keeping that scene. It's because he loves it, you know. He loves his own work, the work of the actors, and the scene is too. Once you get rid of it, there is a rule in the cinema. You never feel sorry after having cut something.
Uh-huh.
You
well,
never
now,
regret. You know.
You know, it's so much easier now with digital.
Yeah.
It used to be, you know, you pull the pins down, process. Now it's like that. Let's see what it looks like without that.
Yeah.
And, you know, there are a lot of advantages.
When you
now,
have the material, you can see the same scene in 3-4 different versions.
Yeah. No, there's a lot of improvement. You know, as I'm sitting here, I'm thinking of the first time I saw Jean-Claude. It was at the Grauman's Chinese Theater. And they had shown, I think it was Discreet Charm of the Bourgeoisie, and you were up in the balcony with Buñuel, and I was down below. And I was looking up at you, and I still look up at you, but it's nice to see you up close now. But it was so awesome to see you, and I'd forgotten there was a lot of, you were at some of those great Hollywood parties at that time with all the great directors.
And I was 72.
And I was there applauding you, as I am now.
Bill?
I just want to say most of the discussion that we've had has been trying to be faithful to a book in terms of what will work on screen. But there's another kind of adaptation, and that is ripping off a book and trying to be unfaithful to it. And we had an example last year, Anne Fontaine made a film called Gemma Bovary, took the book Madame Bovary, and satirized that it was in a little town where a baker was there, and he's all fascinated with Madame Bovary and her story. So when a beautiful woman called Gemma Bovary comes mm-hmm. into town, he starts to try to scheme to not to have the same thing happen to her, and it's a comedy. Yeah. But it's a ripoff kind of adaptation. But I wonder how many of those are around.
And
I
mean, in a way, it's an homage to Flaubert, in a way, you know, to the novelist,
sure. of course.
Yeah. Well, I'd like to have a little thought for Jean-Luc Godard, who is not very well these days.
Oh, yeah. Oh.
So he's a very good friend of mine. He's 1 year older. We've been working together a lot. And he was for us like the conscience of cinema. You know? His look was without any pity, you know, very tough sometimes. But what a personality! Mm-hmm. So let's think about him for a moment, because
you're talking about him in the past tense.
Yeah. Of course. Now he's 86. Mm-hmm. So. But my relationship with him, my memories are that we laughed a lot together, but a lot. He loves to laugh. He loved. And every time he had something absolutely unexpected to say, you know.
Yeah. Mm.
That was extraordinary.
He's very ill now. He's very sick.
Yeah. That's why I'm thinking.
I'm sorry.
You know, Jean-Claude, you remember that house I had in St. Helena?
Yeah.
And Godard was over one time. Tom Luddy brought him over, and we all went for a walk in the woods, and he was sort of lost, and I remember going, whistling, "Hey, Godard," like that. And it was like to see the great Godard lost in the woods. But then I was thinking, I said, I'm thinking of making this movie. I was talking with him, but I think I won't do it, but I'm not sure. So I described the right stuff to him, and he said, I'll do that. And I said, no, I'm going to do that. But, you know, he would have imagined the movie Godard right away. He saw that he wanted to do that. And that, in a way, that pushed me into doing it.
But I tell you something. Of all the directors I have met, not including you, your part, he is the best technician.
Yeah.
He has a fantastic sense of frame. Louis Malle used to say about Truffaut, he doesn't know how to frame, which was right.
About Truffaut?
About Truffaut. Yeah, the frames of Truffaut are clumsy, not really, but Godard. It's impeccable. At the FEMIS, in the film school, to teach the sound, the students about the sound, we used to show them Prénom Carmen, you know, the Godard film, but some music. The complexity of the soundtrack is unbelievable. Unbelievable. You believe you know something. I don't know how many different levels. I mean, he did a work incredible. You know, it's not at all an amateur. He knows his work in a most perfect sense. Jean-Luc.
Mm-hmm. Anything more before we turn to our friends here?
I think they have questions.
Then let's go, please.
Yeah. I'd like to tell you one of my favorite scenes. I will present sometime. I imagine it's a real story, apparently. A man on the 4th century of our time in a desert in Syria. There is a hermit walking, running around, you know, very poorly dressed. And he's screaming, "I have an answer! I have an answer! Who has a question?" We know so many people like this.
Who has a question? Yes.
Could Mr. Carrière talk a little bit about what it was like to write screenplays for films that were not in French, that were in English or Spanish or German? Did you work with a translator? How did that work?
You mean about the different versions? German, I don't know the language at all. I mean, very poorly. But Volker Schlöndorff knows French perfectly well. So I suppose he wanted me to have a foreign look upon the Tindra, which is a typical German word. So we worked together in French, and we wrote a French version, the first one of the film. Then he did the translation into German, helped by Günter Grass. We had a first version, then I went to Berlin with Volker to meet Günter, I knew already, and Günter added some specific expression from the German community in Poland, you know, where the story takes place, you know, in Dansk, in the city of Dansk. That's one way, you know. So I couldn't judge the German version, you know. When the French version and British and Spanish versions, I always have a look, okay, because I know more or less the language, and just to check if, but I, as many times as possible, I leave freedom to the translators. I have been a translator myself, so I know how the translator needs to be free to. He's not a machine, you know, he's not an object. He has a certain way of, I can give you an example. One day Peter Brook decided to direct The Cherry Orchard by Chekhov. I don't know Russian at all. So I said to myself, I'm free, I have a few months of freedom, I can do something else. After Peter knows Russian. He was born in Lithuania, you know, from Lithuania. And his mother-in-law, the mother of his wife, was Russian. So after 2 or 3 days, he called me, because we have in French famous translations by Adamov, by Elsa Triolet, by non-writers of Chekhov, of course. So I said myself, I have nothing to do. After a few days, he called me and he said, could you come to the auditions with the actors for a few moments? So I went, and Peter told me, you know, Chekhov is a writer. He doesn't write like anybody else. He's an author. He doesn't put the words in the usual rhythm or order, you know. And I'd like you to listen. What I was listening in French was absolutely banal, gray, you know, the common, not at all, according to Peter, who speaks French very well, what Chekhov has written. So I said to Peter, let's do an experience. With your mother-in-law, we take, by chance, 2 pages in the play, and we do a translation. She will tell me exactly, not only the meaning. The easiest thing to translate is the meaning. You know, the rest, the rhythm, the deep resonances, no, that's very difficult. So we took, there is a character in the play called Pichik. He's a peasant, and he has a daughter. He's very proud of his daughter because she reads Nietzsche. She reads Nietzsche, and Chekhov says, the peasant says, Nietzsche, this man with colossal brain, you know. And the lady told me, colossal is not a Russian word. So Chekhov used the German colossal with a K. No, colossal. All the translation I had was Nietzsche, this man of a great intelligence, the man of, you know, very banal, you know. An actor cannot play, you know, un homme d'une grande intelligence, you know, but un homme au cerveau colossal, ça oui, that you can play. So the result was that I had to translate the whole play. And my vacations were out. But that's the way, for instance, Kundera told me, that in Anna Karenina by Tolstoy, there is one of the characters who makes mistakes in Russian. He speaks Russian badly. In all the translation, he speaks perfect English, perfect French, because the translator can't receive the blame, mm-hmm. the blame. Mm-hmm. For the,
right, right.
I love to talk about translations because I did four times I worked with Shakespeare, and there's nothing to say, you know. But that's among the best memories of my life, because I was beginning the day from, let's say, from 7 to 9 in the morning, just getting up, you know, with Shakespeare. It's the best possible training for a writer, you know. If I was an athlete, I would join. So Shakespeare was a very nice man. He used to come to my place to sit down. And I said, look, I did this. And he would look at my work and say, yes, it's not bad. The meaning is there. But you see, in English, there is this double sonorities, you know, sound that you don't have in French. So, for instance, in The Tempest, Prospero says, for the famous line, for we are such stuff as dreams are made of. We are such stuff as dreams are made of. All the French translations translate the meaning. Nous sommes de cette étoffe, nous sommes de cette matière dont les rêves sont faits. But Shakespeare told me, if you listen carefully to the English, we are such stuff as dreams are made of. You have twice the sound a draft, you know, which gives some more meaning to the meaning of the phrase, you know, because it's like a wind, you know, passing through the words, you know. So I put, instead of putting matière, I put étoffe, which is the same root as stuff. Car nous sommes de cette étoffe dont les rêves sont faits. You know, and going back, I mean, it's a work, you know, you can't imagine how difficult it is, but how instructive it is. And it's fantastic, but all the secrets of the language are there. Not all of them, but sometimes it's impossible. For instance, in the Timon of Athens, one of the characters says, Timon is a very rich man from Athens, and he was very rich receiving, you know, all his friends, then he loses his money and the friends are leaving him. Shakespeare says in four words, a feast won, fast lost. Four monosyllabic words. Twice F, feast, fast. Fast has a double meaning. Fast means no eating and means rapidly. You know, how can you feast won, fast lost? Twice O, the sound O. You know. Feast won, fast lost. In four, it's like a word, you know, that's absolutely impossible to find the equivalence. You have to choose between the form and the meaning.
Hmm.
I could tell you, let's meet together and we talk for hours about it.
When you were adapting,
not talking about the Mahabharata.
When you were adapting Proust, did you ever think, I must not just do the story, but somehow get the style of Proust into the film?
A certain feeling of time, yes, a certain feeling of time. You know, what I used to say, that I never recommend to read Proust before you are 40. Oops. To read Proust when you are 20, 25 is useless, because you don't have the feeling of time, you know, of something that lasts. Mm-hmm. And when you are 40, 45, you can begin to read Proust until my age. I'm still reading it. It is one of my companions with Balzac, you know. But in the film, it was quite difficult, but we, to use the language, because the dialogue in Proust are poor, you know, they're not, so not to betray that feeling of time, it was easier to give a dialogue to Odette, who is popular, you know, than to Swann, of course, and so on. It's endless, you know. Yeah, yeah.
So wait, there's one here, and then you. First, there's somebody, no, somebody in the back first, and then.
Bonjour. Thank you so much, Monsieur Carrière, for sharing your wisdom with us. I wanted to ask, you have written, co-written with so many different directors, and somehow, and so many amazing films, somehow all the films seem to be very true to the vision of the directors. And I wanted to ask you, what do you think you have brought as a co-writer to all these different films?
Good, I think we'll ask you to repeat that, please.
Sorry.
The question, the last part of the question.
The last part. What do you think you have brought as a co-writer to all these different films?
Qu'est-ce que tu as né en tant que co-auteur à ces écrivains avec lesquels tu as travaillé?
We should ask them. Now, to me, they are the best. I mean, a man like Shakespeare, Proust, they are the best possible companions, you know, in a whole life. And there is no one day in my life without thinking on one of them, without reading something, without, you know. Of course, they are the best possible companions, including some painters and some musicians, of course, you know. Now, do you realize that Shakespeare, Molière, Balzac, and Proust died at 51? Can you imagine what they left behind?
Tu as de ces statistiques absolument.
Descartes à 51 ans.
Maybe we can ask Philip Kaufman, what did Jean-Claude bring to the work you did with him?
Besides all the good dinners we had.
The good dinners, and?
Well, I think that was sort of the nature of the question is, all of the directors you work with, where is the auteur in the screenwriter that could be, if somebody were to do an analysis of all those screenplays, in the DNA of each of the Carrière films, whether, you know, all the directors you work with, would we find your fingerprints, your, well, you know, you can see how, you know, Jean-Claude is, you know, he's a mystifier. He tells you stories. This is all, you know, part of the process when you're working with him is this very thing that we're going through today. This is his way of wrestling with you and with the story and bringing, I mean, I wouldn't know specifically how what he brought to Louis Buñuel, he brought into Unbearable Lightness of Being. I do know that when he wrote with Buñuel, probably mostly by Jean-Claude, My Last Sigh, the book of Buñuel thoughts, that there was in the front of one of Jean-Claude's great cartoons of Buñuel, and it said, Philip, take care of Jean-Claude for me. It was, of course, but it was, you know, passing it on. And I'm sure everyone who he's worked with for any length of time, you know, has... Not only has that film been altered, but hopefully even life to come, you know.
When I was working with Pierre Etex and Tati in Paris, and I was going for 3 months with Buñuel, when I was coming back, Etex used to tell me, you are not the same. You know, something has changed, which is very good. You know? Mm-hmm. I took something from you, from him, from, you know, from the moment you are convinced that you possess the truth, you are lost.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. Well, this is, aside from the films, it's the joy of life and how we get altered by these processes. Yeah. I mean, the films are just something else, but this is...
But a good seller is good, too. You
know? Good seller. Well, I remember that time at your house, you had wonderful dinners, and it was a great group of people around, of your French friends, and the wife of Breton, was it?
Yeah, yeah, Elisa Breton, the wife of André Breton.
You know, all these wonderful, and Jean-Claude lives in this amazing house that Toulouse-Lautrec used to paint in and so forth. And at the end of the meal, or somewhere in the meal, you had a bottle of Napoleonic era wine or something in your cellar. And we were all waiting for this wine, you know. And finally it came, you know, it had to be dusted off.
Yeah, yeah.
And you opened it, everybody's waiting like this, and you tasted it, and you said, merde. And you spit it out, and you said, Let's open a good bottle of wine. And who knows how much that bottle was worth and how much we had all waited for. But it was a great moment. We didn't weep. We didn't. You know. You said let's move the film on.
I think I know a little more about wine than about films.
This gentleman here.
I will try to formulate my question as far as I can. It's a little complicated for me.
Simplify your thought.
First part is this movie that we watched this morning. I watched it like 40 years ago. I don't know, 40 years ago. And how do movies change over time? So mm-hmm. that's one thing. So you saw it 40 years ago, and now you see it again. So that's one thing. And if it can shed light on the relationship of movie making to how the society transitions into new epochs and new eras, if this can shed light on how things go, rivers move into the past, and new eras start, and how movie, I'm not talking about technical aspects of movie making, but how it can reflect society and the growth of, moving of history into forward.
You know, especially for Belle de Jour, the moment you work on a film, it's for that moment when we leave with the film. But sometimes we think about how long the film is going to last. If people will see it in another 10, 20, 25 years, we don't know. But we take a certain number of precautions. Belle de Jour, for instance, including the external aspect. It was the time of Marie Quant in England and the mini-fold, you know? The
mini-skirts.
The mini-skirts, you know? So Catherine Deneuve wanted to have mini-skirts because it was fashionable at that time. And Buñuel was telling me, well, but the miniskirt, I won't last, and one day my film will look out of fashion, just because of this, you know what I mean? So it's just a detail to try to answer you. I knew Yves Saint Laurent. We had been working together. I took Catherine Deneuve to Yves Saint Laurent. And Yves Saint Laurent did the robe for her. Wonderfully, he understood perfectly well, and he got along very well. For the first and only time in his life, Buñuel was watching a fashion défilé, you know? It was incredible. But they got along very well, because Yves Saint Laurent was very bright, and he was a man who had been working with me and Madame Renaud and Jean-Louis Barrault on stage, so he knew perfectly well, and what he did, if you look at the film today, any woman could be dressed like Catherine. You know, there is absolutely, it's perfect. It's forever. The shoes that she wears, you know, in the are still called the Belle de Jour shoes. You know,
really?
It's only a detail, but just to tell you, to try to answer you, that if we believe that the theme of the film, the story, can last, we must also think about the aspect, the external aspect of the film, you know, the way it looks.
This is for Jean-Claude Carrière. So you've talked about spending time in the editing room and how that is a place where the whole film comes together in a way that you either find the script or lose the script.
Speak slowly, please.
Oh, sorry. That you've, yeah, energy. You've talked about spending time in the editing room as a place where the script either comes together or you lose
or
the
not.
Script completely. And
if it's completely lost, there is nothing to do.
Right. You've spent time with Jacques Tati in the editing room?
Yes.
And who's...
At the very beginning, in the editing room of my uncle. But I had not worked on the script. But Jacques Tati, when he understood that I had to know how a film is being made, took me in the post-production of my uncle. You know. And one day, it took me to register the sound of a glass that's falling down and breaks, you know, in the kitchen of the film. So I didn't know anything. I was really, there was a room, a studio, on the ground. There were 12 different sorts of stones, you know, granite, marble, etc. And a lot of different glasses all around, you know, but piles of glasses. And for 2.5 hours, alone with the sound man, he was puff, breaking glass, looking. He had no idea about the sound he wanted, because you can't, with your mouth, imitate. But he was looking for the comic, the perfect sound. And I was there looking for 2 hours, telling myself, is that cinema? Is that a movie? My God. And at one point, one of the glass didn't break and rolled on the floor until my feet, and I laughed. I couldn't. He looked at me and said, very stern, you know. So that was my initiation, you know, into the how to make a film. And also in the editing room with him, he was trying to check if everything was clearly understood in the film. You know, the tail of a dog passed through an electronic eye to close the automatic gate of the garage. Is that clear, you know? Do we see really that it's because of the tail, or do we have to put a close-up? You know, that's a question, you know. He hated to put a close-up. The style was to have, you know. But for hours and hours, again and again, the same image, you know, it's quite boring at the end, you know. But that's how to make a film.
I'm imagining that you spent time in the editing room with other directors at some point. I'm just wondering what you brought from that, from those experiences into your screenwriting, what you kind of carried forward from that.
I can't prevent to think about the editing while I'm writing. I even did some editing on films that I had not written, you know, foreign, all other films from France, which is quite interesting. And it's automatic. When you write, you think about the editing, you know, I think so. You can avoid it, you know. And from time to time, we ask the director, and the director asks you, how do you see it? You know, how do you see it? Is that a series of, it's a long discussion, you know. But you have to know, if the director starts talking to me about techniques, and if I'm unable to answer, he doesn't need me. You know, if Buñuel all of a sudden was an excellent cameraman, starts talking to me about how to shoot, if I say, well, you do whatever you want, it doesn't need me, you know. Okay, ladies and gentlemen.
One more?
One more. Oh, two more, I don't know. Three more.
No, thank you.
So last 2 days, I really enjoyed all of your wonderful stories. And one of the things that really stuck to me is yesterday you shared with us one of your filmmaking secrets, which was like every day or every other day when you're collaborating with your directors, filmmakers, you check whether you're working on the same film. And and for me, like my question to you, Mr. Carrier, is that if you find out that you're not working on the same film, on one scene, certain scene, how do you close the gap? Like, what is the process?
So we better part. We better separate, you know. It happens to me 2 or 3 times. Without quarrel, you know, without any fight. Say, listen, we don't have the same vision of the film at all, so we'd better separate, go our ways, and try to find another collaborator. You know, it's impossible to convince totally somebody who disagrees, who has another vision of the film. Maybe he's right. I don't say I'm right. But I can't get inside his own world. In that case, I gently go. It's needless to insist. It would lead to a fight. And the fight is the worst thing, ever.
I think we have one more there.
There is? All right.
Hello. Yes, I have a question about the relation between words and picture. I mean, when you write a scenario from a novel, what is exactly, how can you make the relation between the picture and with words? Because I think movies is a lot of pictures, images. So the relation between the script and the pictures.
And the film.
The balance and the film, yeah. How can you find this balance? Because it's...
There are different ways. We've been talking a lot about it, you know, how to go from one way of writing to another one. But of course, when you write the script, you think about the film. You try to see the film already.
Yeah, okay.
You know, of course, that's absolutely necessary. Mm-hmm. And sometimes you have some pictures of the setting. Sometimes I do a lot of drawings, description by words, etc. The script is the first form of the film, but we don't have camera yet, you know. So, yeah, as many things as possible that we gather are useful, you know. Even sometimes the color of a dress, you know, of course.
Mm. Well, this may have been the very first question that was asked on Thursday. And so maybe that's the right
the
time to stop.
And the first and the last.
And the last.
Eternal return.
The circle and the eternal return.
So let me so thank first of all of you for being here. And thank Bill and Philip with one L and Atik and Ray. And most of all, thank you, Jean-Claude. No, you have been remarkable. Mm-hmm. And thank you very much. It's been a terrific time you've made us spend together. Thank you very much.
Thank you.